Plenary session. This will be chaired by Professor Shefali Gulati and Professor Dr. Kalpana Datta. Professor Shefali Gulati is a professor coordinator and of the DM Pediatric Neurology Program. She is the chief of the Child Neurology Division, Department of Pediatrics, AIIMS, New Delhi. She is the president elect of the Association of Child Neurology India, the global senior leader for India of the International Society for Autism Research. She is also the chairperson of the Academic of Pediatric Neurology, IAP. She has won multiple awards. Some important ones include the Sheila Wallace Award. She was the first Indian recipient of it. She has received the Fellowship Award by the Faculty of Medicine, McGill University, the Lifetime Achievement Award by the National Neurology Chapter, the 6th Dr. I.C. Verma Excellence in Research Award, the AIIMS Excellence Research Awards, and the Dr. S. Janaki Memorial Award. And the other panelist is our very own Dr. We have Dr. Kalpana Datta with us. Madam is the Professor of Pediatrics, Director of the Pediatric Center of Excellence in HIV Care, Medical College, Kolkata. She is the President, Vice President, NIBI member of several important boards. She has more than 52 publications. She is a researcher and has acted as the guide in many researches. The author of the chapter of textbook of Pediatric Neurology and Pediatric Hemato-Oncology. The reviewer of many journals and national technical guidelines, the convener of the WBAP Women's Wing, and also a life member of the IAP NNF, the Infectious Disease and Rheumatology Chapter of the IAP, ISPGHAN, PAN, AOCN, and ICN. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Vasundhara, for your kind introductions. I think, Dr. Shefali, are you here? Dr. Shefali? She has sent a video, I think. I should play that video. She has already sent a video, Dr. Shefali. Otherwise, I will start. It's not there? But I can't also. Actually, she is traveling. Dr. Shefali is traveling, so she has already sent a video on behalf of her. She wants to say something about the Dr. Kala. Okay, so I'm starting. Now, the plenary session by our own, very own respected eminent professor, Veena Kala, though she doesn't need any introduction. But as a customary, I'll introduce her. She's a senior consultant pediatric neurology, Apollo Hospital, New Delhi. Director of the Child Center, New Delhi, formerly professor and head of the department, All India Institute of Medical Science, New Delhi. Recipient of many prestigious awards, especially I would like to mention three honorable president awards from the three honorable president of India in 1969, 1991, and 2008. She has the founder member of the neurology DM at All India Institute of Medical Science, New Delhi, and recipient of the 31 medals and awards. She bestowed the Swasth Bharat Samman by ZTV and LIC, implemented more than 60 research projects in child neurology, published 230 research papers in prestigious national and international journals, contributed many books, among which the pediatrics and child neurology is the prominent one. Author of the Practical Pediatric Neurology, editorial board of several Indian and foreign prestigious journals, board of governors of Swami Ram Himalayan University, Jolly Grant, Dehradun, India, founder president of Association of Child Neurology India, former president Asian Oceanian Child Neurology Association, and chairperson Educational Committee of International Child Neurology Association of World, USA. Thank you all. I think over to you, Veena Kala, ma'am, please.
Thank you.
Shefali is traveling. Yeah. She has already sent the video.
Right. Good afternoon. I wish to thank the organizers for this prestigious invitation to the PCNI 2021. I wish all the organizers, the faculty, and the delegates a very nice festive season and Diwali forthcoming ahead. Wish you all be safe and happy and healthy. I begin my talk about strategies of prevention of neurodisability. Can you see the slides? Can you see the slides?
Yes, ma'am. You can make it a slide mode or yes.
Is it okay?
All right. Yes, ma'am. It's audible okay. And visible too. Okay.
Thank you. So I'm going to talk about strategies of reduction of neurodisability. We know in any disease, reducing the cause of the disease is really tantamount to reducing the burden in the country. So when we talk about which I think is a challenge for the future. In India, the intrapartum reduction needs to be taken care of. We also need to reduce natal conicterus, risk factors like sepsis, meningitis, hypoglycemia, all of them. CNS infections like meningitis, encephalitis, TBM, malaria, SSPE, dengue, etc. Iodine deficiency, a good 75 million population suffers from it, resulting in iodine deficiency disorders, intellectual disability, stunting, and hypothyroidism. Inborn errors of metabolism are a preventable mental challenge because there's hope and treatment for many of them. Hearing and visual impairment needs to be identified early so as to make the disabled able for the community. Intellectual disability is again a very common cause. These were the WHO and UNICEF estimates. I must compliment the INCLIN, which did a very stellar study, which is population-based multi-site survey across 5 regions of the country. Neuromotor impairment equal to cerebral palsy, epilepsy, hearing impairment, visual impairment, autistic spectrum disorders, speech and language disorders, and intellectual disability in children between the ages of 2 and 6, and ADHD and learning disability additionally in children between the ages of 6 to 9. So comprehensively, it covered 2 to 9 years old children. The outcome of this study was, I would come to the last think first, 1 out of 8 children have at least 1 neurodevelopmental disability. 1 out of 8 children. The site-specific prevalence was highly variable from 3% to 18%. Site-specific prevalence of the 9 neuromuscular neurodisabilities was between 6 to 9 years, was 6.5 to 19%. 1/5 of them had multiple disabilities, which means more than one. Hearing impairment and intellectual disability was the commonest across all sites. So therefore, we have to realize that 1 out of 8 children have a problem that we are addressing to today. They also identified risk factors, because identification of risk is tantamount to what steps you take for prevention. Domiciliary birth to be avoided at all costs. There's been a huge governmental action in this regard, which we must laud. Perinatal asphyxia, neonatal illness is to be reduced. Postnatal infantile causes of CNS infections, sepsis, low birth weight, gestation below 37 weeks, and a traumatic birth injury, all of which need to have efforts put in that regard. Coming next to infections, which are a great preventable opportunity. This is the low-lying fruit in which effort can yield great results in every form of disease and infection anywhere in the world. Infections, neuroinfections, have a fatality rate of 16 to 36%, produce mental retardation in about 1/3 of them, sensory neural hearing loss in almost 10 to 25%, seizures, which are often intractable, in 30%, and miscellaneous disabilities in 10 to 20%. Vaccines are a very cost-effective strategy, have been implemented, but need to be strengthened. Coming then to the history of polio in India, it was a major cause of lameness, 64.5%. Between the years 1979 to 1988, there were 2 to 4 lakh diagnosed paralytic polio cases yearly, every year, 2 to 4 lakh children paralyzed and limp for life. Children paralyzed due to polio daily, 500 to 1,000. Laudable National Polio Health Surveillance Program and the WHO and the Ministry of Health and the government and every individual involved in this project. A creation of a national polio network, tackling wild polio viruses nationally, and set up an expert review committee for AFP classification. For the last 15 years, I'm a member of this committee till date. Now, what did this achieve? It achieved a certified polio-free India. First of all, there was elimination of type 2, then type 3, and last type 1. And since 2011, we haven't seen a case of wild polio virus polio. And the Sierra has certified us as a polio-free country. I think we really need to be proud of that. Then coming to other infections, meningitis. A hospital-based multi-site survey indicated in the map of India between the years 2012 to 2013. Studied case records of 19,760 childhood fevers, of which almost 3,000 were suspected meningitis, and there were confirmed meningitis and suspected meningitis. So almost about 4,000 out of the 19,000 plus childhood fevers turned out to be meningitis. So therefore, we have to be aware of this possibility when a child comes to us with a fever that doesn't settle or a fever that behaves differently. What were the common organisms? Strep pneumoniae in 82.9%, Neisseria in 2.7%, Hib in 14.4%. The UIP vaccination program included the PCV vaccine in the year 2017. H influenza was the commonest global cause of acute bacterial meningitis in 1990. India was a little late in elimination. And so therefore, the study indicated that 14.4% was still due to Hib, which resulted in application of the Hib vaccine on a very large basis. And post-Hib vaccine, it has now become the least common cause, and 83 to 95% decline in Hib. Childhood Hib is almost eliminated in the West. So therefore, we have had a major stride in acute bacterial meningitis. We still need to be alert. Coming then to Japanese B encephalitis, both endemic and epidemic in our country, have a mortality of 1 out of 4. But what we are talking about today is a morbidity of 50%. There are no major treatment avenues, so prevention is the answer. Live vaccine has an efficacy of 100%, has some side effects. Chimeric vaccine, 2 dose, started as a national program. Genvac indigenous vaccine, which has a seroconversion of 90% in the national program. But never forget vector control, medicated nets, fogging, vaccination, and covering yourself up in the dengue season to prevent yourself from dengue and Japanese encephalitis. Then coming to neurocysticercosis, it is the commonest preventable cause of acquired epilepsy recognized in the WHO studies, also in the Indian studies. 60% of first partial seizures in children above 3 years were due to neurocysticercosis. This was a study at Ames that we conducted. What we also did was to study the schools and do a CAP survey of school teachers, physicians, and parents. This pilot school-based program identified that there was a huge information gap among the parents, teachers, students, municipal workers, and even the school physicians. They did not know enough of prevention of neurocysticercosis. cysticidal therapy became to be an accepted modality of treatment, which the country is really following at large now. Prevention of teniasis and cysticercosis needs proper washing of vegetables, fruits, and hands. I think we had a very good traditional practice of being very clean in terms of washing hands, in terms of washing vegetables, in terms of washing fruits, in terms of washing hands before eating. I don't know why we relented on this age-old legacy. We really need to revive that. Adequate treatment of all infected persons, improving animal husbandry using oxfendazole in pig poultry farms, meat inspection, and community prophylaxis with albendazole are some of the community measures. Coming next to CNS tuberculosis, India has a huge 26% global burden of tuberculosis. A national TB control program with a DOTS program with a notifiable disease status of tuberculosis is in place, which has made a dent on tuberculosis for the country. We now see lesser TBM. We see less severe forms of TBM, but we still see a lot of tuberculoma. And we all need to be aware, undernutrition, measles, post-COVID, and presence of HIV increases opportunity of tuberculosis attacking the CNS, and be aware in all these situations. Next, coming to other viral infections producing things like GBS, a study done at Ames indicated the association of Campylobacter as an etiological agent for GBS. 28% of GBS had Campylobacter association, even though a small proportion of them had diarrhea. So you may miss the association of diarrhea, C. jejuni, unless you investigate. Mycoplasma pneumoniae, again, another cause, but it was not statistically significant. This was, again, another study done at Ames. Now coming to subacute sclerosing panencephalitis, a very drastic disease, tortures the child, tortures the family on a long-term basis. Answer is measles immunization. We did go down on our measles control program, and very wisely the health ministry, the WHO, participated in augmenting the measles program in the community and increasing the coverage. The tests that need to be done if you suspect a patient is an EEG to look for periodic discharges, a brain MRI, not very critical, a CSF, and blood measles antibody is something that clinches the diagnosis. Prevention is measles vaccine. It's the only preventable strategy for an SSPE. Coming then to prevention of other conditions like cerebral palsy, which is the third major contributor of disability. Primary prevention must begin from womb, extremes of maternal age, bad health, background disorders, family history of cerebral palsy must be identified as the first step red flag signs of a mother who's become pregnant. Giving folic acid, good nutrition, iodine, trace elements, watching her hemoglobin, watching her thyroid, watching for intrauterine infections, and now bacterial vaginosis are important primary preventive steps. The pregnancy should be watched. There should be a monitoring of fetal head size, fetal growth, ultrasound to look for congenital malformations, which are observed in 2 to 3% of pregnancies. Looking for neural tube defects, Down syndrome. It's very unfortunate that a lot of mothers go through ultrasound, yet NTDs and Down syndrome are missed because these are done as an obstetric ultrasound and not done as an ultrasound to look for fetal anomalies, which is what we have to stress about. Okay. Next is safe supervised birth and reduce preterm births by all possible methods available today. In addition to this, then we next come to antenatal genetic testing. As I mentioned, congenital anomalies in 2 to 3% pregnancies. Therefore, fetuses with ultrasound abnormalities must be repeated by radiologists. Fetal MRIs should be done. Then karyotyping, a PCR, a CMA, and a diagnostic yield of about up to 81%. And then we can now go on to doing complete exome analysis in the fetus. Absence of detected causative variants do not exclude genetic syndrome, but they certainly reduce their prevalence. Prenatal exome sequences, we have to do them in all patients who require it. Preterm neuroprotection. Reviews for neuroprotection in children. Cochrane analysis of 227 RCTs, which have dealt with 32,490 children, identified magnesium sulfate versus placebo in 5 trials to have reduced relative risk by 0.68%. So it may be a good strategy to adopt. CP reduced at 18 to 24 months by use of some of the following methods: antenatal steroids, one versus multiple. And the pediatric data reveals that a single dose antenatal steroid is better than multiple dosing. Prophylactic antibiotics before new membrane rupture increase risk. Prophylactic vitamin K and erythropoietin are additional factors that can be used. Then in term or near-term infants, neuroprotection with therapeutic hypothermia. Neurological output following HIE can be improved by selective head cooling, servo-controlled methods, and total body cooling by phase-changing materials, a picture of which I've shown an adaptation from, which was produced by some of our associates from South India. They forwarded this as an initial step. Therapeutic hypothermia should start within 6 hours of birth, maintained for 72 hours. Rewarming should happen over 12 hours, and there should be a strict rectal temperature control not to fall below 32 degrees centigrade. There are some plus minus recent outcomes that have come into picture. International trials, there were multiple trials which reduced relative risk by 0.6 to 0.86%. In a resource-limited setting, as I mentioned, PCM is something that's possible. Adverse effects may include stroke, coagulopathy, sepsis, thrombocytopenia, and death. Now, neonatal hypoglycemia is a very, very easily preventable birth injury and comes with very severe consequences of early West syndrome, severe neurodisability, and severe CP. Therefore, always monitor blood glucose level. Remember that even though there are alternate fuels that are present, but very often the child suffers a damage if the glucose levels are reduced. Look, one, for feeding as a cause, but also look for other causes like hyperinsulinemia, counter-regulatory hormones, poor gluconeogenesis, glycogen storage disorders, and metabolic disorders, including glucose transport defects. Therefore, protect occipital parietal lobes by maintaining blood sugar. So therefore, suspect early, investigate promptly, and treat urgently. Cerebral palsy, the important thing is to prevent impairment going on to disability. Early recognition of variations of tone, movement, feeding, sleep, and seizures, counseling, therapy often unattended, so we must be careful about early intervention and early therapies. Attend medical needs of tone management, seizures, nutrition, and feeding, never to be forgotten. Watch milestone achievement and early ambulation to prevent contractures. There are very new devices that are available, which include a MOLLY suit, robotic devices, as well as a many other interventional new devices that I've shown in pictures, which we could take advantage of in the coming years. Remember, DBS in dystonic CP is under great investigation and may be a very useful tool in selected cases. Childhood epilepsy is a huge burden, 5.4 to 22 per thousand population. The treatment gap is higher in rural, which we all know. So therefore, we must decentralize therapy. Okay. We must empower the community to deal with it. We must encourage use of common drugs for adequate periods of time so as to be available, affordable, and so that families can adopt to it on a continuous basis. 50% of epilepsy is treatable at community level, and we have no reason for it not to be available there. Preventable epilepsy, I think we've already talked about oxygen, glucose, bilirubin, neurocysticercosis, and I would talk about here about some inborn errors of metabolism which should be identified early. Febrile seizures, prevention to go into febrile status is important. Post-vaccination identification of seizures and identifying that some are genetically predisposed to get a seizure post-vaccination. This category should be newly recognized, a category should be attended to. Measles I've already talked about. Now, all mothers who have children who've had an epilepsy, all of them, whether they have febrile seizures, whether they have intractable epilepsy, whether they've had a post-traumatic epilepsy, need to be empowered with the use of benzodiazepines at home, domiciliary use, use in transit, use before they are, when they are waiting in the hospital emergency. And this is something that must be encouraged at all levels. The first study we published from our country was a rectal diazepam for febrile seizure prophylaxis, published by Ames in 1980 and presented at ICNAC, Hawaii. Subsequently, we had very cumbersome methods of giving suppositories, cannula, using midazolam vials, but the pharmaceutical industry has produced good options, intranasal midazolam, oral dissolvable buccal doses of clonazepam and lorazepam. So therefore, its use must be propagated. The new kid on the block is the genetic epilepsies. You have novel genes, you have common genes, and you have newer ones that are coming up every day. So I think in this, I only need to say that if you have an intractable epilepsy, if you have familial epilepsy, if you have recurrent vaccine-precipitated seizures, or if you have epilepsy with a neurocognitive decline, or if you have an epileptic who goes frequently into non-convulsive status, please do look for a genetic basis of epilepsy in your child. Then is precision medicine, which has come on in a big way in tuberous sclerosis. Vigabatrin, an open label study in tuberous sclerosis, which indicated that the moment you have an abnormal EEG, before you have seizures, you start treating with vigabatrin. This is a preventive measure for epilepsy. This also reduces the neurocognitive decline which these children may have. Then are the more specific rapalogs, which include sirolimus, everolimus, which are useful in intractable epilepsies of tuberous sclerosis, also used in the SEGAs and TANDS. TANDS is this neuropsychiatric symptoms that you get in adolescent children most of the time. And SEGA is the tumor-like thing that you get in tuberous sclerosis, for which they should be monitored every 2 years. Biomarkers to identify patients destined for epilepsy and wearables to warn oncoming seizures in children who have frequent epilepsies. Are some of the newer things that you can use. Surgical intervention for drug-resistant epilepsy, which is almost 20 to 30%, is an unavailable, unaffordable, underutilized, great benefit opportunity. Therefore, this must be encouraged. Pre-surgical evaluation has to be done by the clinicians, the medical fraternity, And therefore, we have to tie hands with the surgeons so that this benefit can come on timely to reduce this huge treatment gap. Vagal nerve stimulator is also an entity that is. Here, I'd just like to mention that one of the disabling causes, the most disabling cause in an adult, which began in childhood and goes on in families, is inherited polyneuropathies. It's something that we don't realize and don't recognize. So if you have this family history of a neuromotor, slow neuromotor disability, identify and look for your children and even antenatal diagnosis to prevent it. Next, coming to nutrition. Iron deficiency in the first year results in a 7-point IQ drop. So therefore, it's a huge opportunity. This is an early trauma, late defect, and iron deficiency is easily preventable. Iodine deficiency, huge neurological burden. Meta-analysis of 19 studies show that in iodine deficient areas, there's a 13.5 IQ point drop if you don't treat these, the community. Neural tube defects, pretty common in the community, 4.1 to 10.4%. Some can, about 10% are syndromic, 90% are non-syndromic and have a preventable entity with a periconceptional 5-mg folic acid to be given 1 month before and into pregnancy. Okay. Now this reduces anencephaly by 90%, spina bifida by 72%, and it prevents birth of affected fetuses. So it's not just folic acid. There are other causes, retinol, tocopherol, pantothenic acid, zinc, pyridoxine, B12, which should be looked for in families which have a recurrent history. Now coming to the thing that we encountered the most in our clinical practice, autism, prenatal intervention. I'm only talking of the preventable aspects. Maternal folic acid supplements lower ASD rate by 0.64%. Let's not forget this as an added advantage to give folic acid to pregnant mothers. Levine from Israel found on a prospective study on 45,000 plus mothers that it lowers relative risk by 0.2. Schmidt in a prospective study from USA found that ADOS done at 3 years, folic acid in pregnancy in the first month reduced relative risk by 0.38. These are not significant, but these indicate some possibilities of reduction. In these mothers, caffeine in pregnancy is not associated with ADHD risk. It's something that has come up. The using large quantities of fresh fruit, vegetable, whole grain is something that's healthy. Now, what's new in folic acid on the autistic spectrum front is Norwegian mother and child cohort followed from 1999 to 2008 indicated that there were lower malformations in higher IQs in this large Norwegian cohort and lesser risk of ASD. So therefore, don't forget this for autistic families. Autism are looking. Prevention is early prevention, early behavior identification, educational challenges, alternative intervention, and approaching them with both therapies, drugs, identifying some genetic causes and intervening with them directly, like for instance, Fragile X, etc. Blood lead is another cause of neuromorbidity. This is our study from Ames, which indicated that blood lead level was high, and a blood lead level of more than 10 micrograms resulted in a drop of IQ by about 4 to 7, and about 10% of our children had high blood lead levels in a study in Delhi. Now vision. A rainbow program on 56 lakh identified that 0.17% in Indian children have problems, of which large majority had refractive errors, which could improve and give rise to better opportunities. Otherwise, vitamin A deficiency, eye care, genetic causes, must all be investigated in children who have eye abnormalities in an index child. Hearing loss. Just look at this column of 85 decibels and above. These are preventable causes of hearing disability. Loud horns, loud fireworks, loud sirens, etc. And these are causes of preventable hearing loss. The many rest of them are often genetic, syndromic, associated with infections, associated with drugs used to treat infections. Learning disability, the important tips for prevention are that identify your children early. Some are visual learners, some are auditory learners, some are kinesthetic learners. So even though you can't correct the disability, you can promote learning in the child. Then coming to early diagnosis of treatable inborn errors and identifying them early. So there has been a lot of effort in doing screening. The overall impression is that congenital hypothyroidism, hearing, screening at birth are the two that must be universally accepted. High inborn errors and metabolism could be done in selective communities and states where the incidence turns out to be high. Expanded newborn screening should be used in selective populations, either with a family history or in sick newborns with an inborn error of metabolism suspected. In the rest could be usual screening. Genetic basis of neurodevelopment. Remember that in all countries, high and low and middle income countries, these are a very important cause. It is being addressed in a very big way, but we still have lots of challenges in this regard. Testing modalities for IEM, all IEMs are genetic, therefore must confirm them by genetic testing to prevent a second IEM being born in a family. I would mention the small box number 3. In a community setting, remember to do glucose, electrolytes, lactate, acid base, ammonia, ketones, and homocysteines in all suspected cases. If suspected on these grounds, in every clinical setup, then we can go ahead to wherever the rest are available, doing a TMS, and genetics. Sanger sequencing is the gold standard for detecting genetic disorders, but an NGS Sanger is rather expensive. You need to have a single disorder. You need to know what gene you are testing. You need to know the hotspots, and it becomes almost difficult, impossible. Therefore, the next generation sequencing is what we generally resort to. We must know here that a patient may have a disorder which has a great genetic heterogeneity. So therefore, there's not one gene. There are multiple genes that have to be addressed, and this can be addressed through the NGS. So therefore, one of several potential genes which we are looking for may be identified. There may be obvious candidate genes that have to be tested. The cost of NGS is surely less than the Sanger sequencing route. The NGS, you can have a targeted gene panel, which is often used for identified disorders like IEM, lysosomal disorders, neuromuscular disorders, immune deficiencies, epilepsies. Then is the clinical exome, which identifies 5 to 6,000 clinically relevant genes. Then is the whole exome sequencing, which identifies about 20,000 genes, and a whole genome sequence, which is rather expensive, which identifies all exons and introns. So this is the journey we are pursuing right now. So good phenotyping, when we select, it's important to know what we select. Remember that if you're looking for a triple repeat disorder like a Fragile X, NGS is not the answer. Therefore, we must know what we are looking for before doing NGS. And when we are doing NGS, we must know what is the depth and coverage of the gene that we are looking for in the NGS. Steps for genetic prevention. First is early detection, suspicion, and interaction. to prevent birth of an affected child, which is like a primary prevention. If you've had one child, then we have to be more strong in our investigative approach. We must do complete genetic testing of the index child and of the parents and of the antenatal screening of the child. Tertiary prevention implies that we must diagnose them early, prevent their disability, and manage their symptoms. Then the other thing is that if you have genetic disorders, not the IEM, doing genetic counseling to look for high risk, to do premarital genetic counseling, to do a prenatal genetic counseling, a neonatal genetic counseling, and a genetic counseling for the general population based on population risks. So this is the domain of the geneticist, but the neuromorbidity has to get in touch with them to attend to these issues. There is one message that I have to convey that all of us are doing a lot of next generation sequencing, but we are not collating the clinical data enough with the NGS. Neither the labs are collating nor the clinicians are collating. And this is an opportunity lost if we don't make a step forward in this regard. And therefore, I think if I have to give one message today is that as far as genetic is concerned, we must make a step. The institutions should make an effort to get this on board, that the clinical phenotype and the genetic must be correlated better, and a huge database must be generated from our country. Pre-implantation genetic testing and pre-implantation genetic diagnosis has come of age, and it's a huge step forward to prevent monogenic disorders and also to prevent other structural disorders, other genetic disorders, aneuploidies in the population. There's different testing options at different stages of disease include diagnosing the disease, predicting the disease risk, determining the carrier status of parents, doing a pre-implantation testing, and doing a prenatal screening and testing. Something that has always been close to my heart, but I never find enough information, is what does a hypothyroid mother give to the child in even a subtle manner? I have always felt that when I get the history, hypothyroidism in the mother is very commonly elicited in autistic mothers, in mothers who've had a cerebral palsy child, in mothers who've had a child with a global developmental delay. So not enough information is available. Perhaps it's not, I don't know whether it's as common or not, but I would say that women with subclinical hypothyroidism with positive TPO antibodies have the highest risk of adverse pregnancy outcomes. This is a huge statement, and we must attend to this. So therefore, I think this is also another important avenue of prevention of neuromorbidity. What is the government effort in this regard? There's been a huge government effort in the last decade or more than a decade. These are the four Ds that the national program is doing for the maternal and child health: identification of birth defects at birth, identification of development delay, creating a child protection and a child development card, looking at children through the Anganwadi workers, and checking them at 6 to 19 years in their schools and their relative colleges. So therefore, this is a huge program that has been initiated, and one must laud the government for this. These are the various delivery points. These are some of the efforts that have been made with this huge team that has been trained to identify these disorders early and maybe bring them to the intervention centers. These are some of the district intervention centers which have been created and are still under creation, and I think that's a very great step forward. But remember, at all this, family is the center. The family must be educated, the parents must be educated. Education is power. Information is all important. Empowerment of the family is crucial. coping strategies by the healthcare workers, by the government programs, by the doctors, by the super specialists is important, but all this centers to empowering the family. Family history, always in consanguineous families, born them early. Information awareness for prevention, importance of antenatal, natal, postnatal care, immunization milestones, good child rearing practices, good nutrition, stimulation if the child is not performing, change the societal fabric to look at these children with a different eye, change the family dynamics and the ethos so that these children also get their due. So I would say that we have to be champions of ability through disability. I would remind you of the Paralympians recently who did as well or maybe better than our healthy Olympians. They were all people who had disabilities. We have blind musicians who have done great. We have autistic children who are today in the hospitality sector and have got jobs. And there are children who have really come and got government jobs despite their disabilities. We need to encourage our families not to despair. And I think that's the most important message. Encourage families to join hands with them. Out of my own practice, I have had a blind child whom we have trained to be a drummer, and he's now in a national band. An ADHD child who was hugely hyperactive, had huge power, huge boy. He's now in the national swimming championship of Delhi. So I think each one of us can do our bit. Remember the 1 billion COVID vaccinations that the country did is the same country that should help these disabled children to come about. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your brilliant deliberation on strategies to reduce neurodisability. It's complete, but yet comprehensive too. So as it's a plenary session, there will be no questions. And in the beginning, we have not played the message which is sent by the Dr. Shefali Gulati. So please play the video which is sent by the Shefali Gulati in favor of Madam Kalla.
As chairperson of the Academy of Pediatric Neurology, Indian Academy of Pediatrics, and scientific chairperson for NeuroPediCon 2021, I welcome you all to this academic extravaganza. I'm sorry I'm not sitting in the hall with you currently due to some medical challenges at home front. I have recorded this message as I'm currently on the way to the airport to come to Kolkata. I'm very happy to introduce the speaker of today's plenary session, Professor Veena Kalra, who actually needs no introduction as she is a pioneer in the field of child neurology in India and has been my mentor. Under her able guidance, we started the first DM Pediatric Neurology program in South Asia way back in 2004. She has been an excellent academician, astute clinician, and professional par excellence. The topic for the plenary session is strategies to reduce neurodisability, which is very apt because it is in sync with the theme of the conference, Intact Neurosurvival, Better Tomorrow. She has been recipient of many international and national awards. I would request Professor Kalpana Datta, organizing chairperson of the NeuroPediCon 2021, to formally introduce Madam from her CV slide. I will remain logged in till I board the aircraft. Thank you.
Thank you all.